يا رسول الله يا حبيب الله يا رسول الله يا حبيب الله
سلام عليك سلام
يا نبي سلام عليك
سلام
يا رسول سلام عليك
سلام
صلوات الله عليك
سلام عليك
سلام
يا نبي سلام عليك
سلام
يا رسول سلام عليك
سلام
صلوات
سلام عليك مصطفى خير البرا هو سرور گردو سرا هو مصطفى خير البرا هو سرور گردو سرا هو اپنے اچھوں کا تصدق ہم بدوں کو بھی دیوا ہو
سلام علی سلام
یا نبی سلام علی
سلام
یا رسول سلام علی
سلام
صلوات
سلام عليك
سلام
يا نبي سلام عليك
سلام
يا رسول سلام عليك
سلام
صلوات الله عليك
سلام عليك ملك خاص كبرياء و مالك غر ما سوا هو ملك خاص كبرياء و مالك غر ما سوا هو کوئی کیا جانے
with their presence, the first one, the grandson of Muhaddis-e-Azam Pakistan, who isn't aware of who Muhaddis-e-Azam Pakistan is. We're all very familiar with this esteemed and renowned family, their services for the Ahl-e-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah and for the Muslim world. Nobody needs an introduction to them. Sahib Zada Hussain Raza, he's joined us, and the honorable guest from Birmingham, another renowned personality, Imam Ijaz Ahmed Shami. He's also joined us on behalf of the Sunni Foundation and everybody present. I'd like to welcome both of the honorable guests. It's an honor to have you here, and inshallah at the appropriate time we're going to benefit from your talks and your address. Alhamdulillah, we have an array of esteemed scholars who've traveled from across the UK to be present with us tonight, so let's take benefit from them. My next speaker is a young imam who's got a significant following throughout the United Kingdom. He's the co-founder of the Al-Hikam Institute here in Bradford. He's known for his analytical skills, his thought-provoking lectures, and he's currently leading the Friday prayer at the Makkah Masjid in Bolton. Our honorable guest, Sheikh Mufti Munawwar Atiq, is joining us. Let's welcome him with the traditional slogans, Nara-e Takbir, Nara-e Risalat, Nara-e Risalat, Nara-e Risalat. MashaAllah, it'd be nice if everybody responded to Nara-e Risalat. Nara-e Risalat, Nara-e Risalat, Nara-e Risalat.
Alhamdulillah, الذي أبدع الأفلاك والأرضين. والصلاة على من كان نبيا وآدم بين الماء والطين وصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وابتغوا إليه الوسيلة صدق الله مولانا العظيم ببركة إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ونبينا وشفينا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصلي عليه Each and every one of you join in. As-salatu was-salamu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulallah wa ala alika wa ashabika ya Sayyidi ya Habiballah. As-salatu was-salamu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulallah wa ala alika wa ashabika ya Sayyidi ya Rahmatan lil Alameen. One more time, koi zaban hamosh na rahe. As-salatu was-salamu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulallah wa ala alika wa ashabika ya Sayyidi ya Khataman Nabiyyin. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. After praising Allah Almighty Jalla Jalaluhu and sending infinite peace and salutations, durood and salawat upon the best of creation, the light of creation, the purpose of creation. Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen, Sayyidul Anbiya wal Mursaleen, Sultani Medina, Nure Sina, Ahmad Mustafa wal Mujtaba, Sallallahu Alaihi wa Ala Alihi wa Ashabihi wa Baraka wa Sallam. Most honorable and respectable ulama-i karam, mothers and fathers, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Tonight, no doubt, is a historical night. Because you see in front of you many of the shining stars of the Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'at. Current and future torchbearers of the Maslak of Ala Hazrat, Azim Barakat, Mujaddid Deen o Millat, Imam Ahmad Riza Khan alayhi rahmat wa ridwan. And no doubt each and every one of us, whether it be the ulama-i karam or the awam, have accepted the invitation given by Sunni Foundation, and each and every one of us has said labbaik. And also we have proven our loyalty and our commitment by coming in our hundreds, if not thousands, tonight on this night. This is a testimony to the hard work and the efforts of Sunni Foundation, Bil Khusus Chaudhry Imran Sahib and the rest of his team. This vision and commitment to the cause is a step in the right direction. This isn't the be-all or the end-all. It is the a step in the right direction. And inshallah, no doubt, if we remain unified, we remain as one unit, then there is no force on this earth which can destroy us. And there is no force on this earth which can overcome us. Why? Because in our seena is the ishq and adab of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our heart is the love and ghulami of the Ahlul Bayt-i Athar. And in our chest is the love and the mahabbat and adab towards the Sahaba-i Karam. There is no force on this earth which can destroy this. There is no force on this earth which can overcome this. And no doubt with the variseen of the Anbiya, our ulama-i Karam leading the way, holding the torch of light in these difficult and dark times, no doubt we are heading in the right direction. And alhamdulillah, it's very pleasing to see that this isn't just an arm jalsa. It's not just a gathering where people just come and praise Sunni Foundation, talk about one another positively or negatively. Alhamdulillah, a clear direction and an agenda has been set, where ulama have been given thought-provoking topics, and topics which no doubt are the need of the time. I've been given the task of talking about tasawwuf, spirituality, and in reality, Huzur Data Ali Hujwairi Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, who wrote Kashful Mahjub, which is a manuscript of tasawwuf, and they say that if a person doesn't have a sheikh, he doesn't have a peer, doesn't have a murshid, but he is a student of Kashful Mahjub, then this is sufficient for that individual. Such is the power in Huzur Data Ali Hujwairi, Sayyid Ali bin Uthman Al-Hujwairi, Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, Kashful Mahjub. Data Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi came around 1,000 years ago. The Kashf al-Mahjub, the unveiling of the veil, like I said, is a manuscript in tasawwuf and spirituality. But Data Sahib mentioned in their introduction of Kashf al-Mahjub, in their time and in their zamana, that tasawwuf, spirituality, ye kaal ki baat hai, ye haal ki baat nahi. Ye subhanallah ni baat nahi. Data Sahib, 1,000 years ago, they are saying tasawwuf, spirituality,
کال کی بات ہے حال کی بات نہیں
You see, in the time of Data Ali Hujwari, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, putting into a historical perspective, a lot of fake Sufis emerged, claimants of tasawwuf and spirituality, people who were put on the garbs and the clothing of a Sufi, but inside they would be empty and hollow. Data Sahib in the introduction is saying 1,000 years ago, that tasawwuf kaal ki baat hai, hal ki baat nahi. And if this is Data Sahib speaking 1,000 years ago, then what is the state of the society that we live in today? Afsos ki baat hai na? 1,000 years have passed since Data Ali Hujwari, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, graced us. And they said that the soul of spirituality, kaal ki baat hai, hal ki baat hai. This is why to begin with, the soul of spirituality isn't something that you can explain. The soul of spirituality is something that you experience. There's a difference between explanation and a experience. Tasawwuf spirituality is something that you experience, it overcomes you. It becomes a means of your change. It becomes a means of your being a mu'min and a Muslim. And no doubt tasawwuf, if you look at how this word came about, we will shed some light upon this. And then inshallah Azza wa Jal will touch upon another aspect of this. But the tasawwuf, if you touch upon or look at the root of this word, many of the ulama have given their opinions that lafz-e tasawwuf, which remember evolved like other terms within the Sharia, within Islam, you have terms such as fiqh, which were not used in the time and zaman of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, kalam, physics, sarf, nahv, these ulooms which no doubt were being taught, but they weren't in the naming or the form that we know them as today. This is the same with tasawwuf and spirituality as well. The first person and the first individual to write upon the ideologies and the teachings of tasawwuf was the great Sayyidina Zunnun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyidina Zunnun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He was the first individual to truly put together the ideologies and the forms of tasawwuf and spirituality. Prior to him, the form of or the name of tasawwuf was used in different ways, like Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala uses in the Quran, tazkiya, qad aflaha man tazakka. Successful are those people who purified themselves. This is something established by way of the Quran. Tazkiya in the Quran, khawf in the Quran, fear in the Quran. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala touches upon this aspect in different ways. Similarly, you find this in the ahadith mubarakah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Lafz-e tasawwuf is not used, but you'll find that the word ihsan is used. That famous narration when a man comes to Barghai Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Each and every one of you says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One more time, sallallahu. A man came into the court of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Famous narration, long narration, taweel riwayat. And this individual we know asked a series of questions. Akhbirni anil Islam, akhbirni anil Iman. And the third question, akhbirni anil Ihsan. That, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inform me what is Ihsan. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ihsan is that you worship Allah Almighty as if you are witnessing Him, as if you see Him. And if you can't attain this level and rank, know that Allah Almighty Jalla Jalaluhu is witnessing and seeing you. He sees you. He's the all-hearing. He's the all-seeing. Allahu Akbar walillahi alhamd. So concept of Ihsan is touched upon in the ahadith mubarakah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam talk about the importance of the purification of the heart, the jinan. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْزُرُ إِلَىٰ أَجْسَادِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ سُوَرِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْزُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَنِيَّاتِكُمْ وَعَمَالِكُمْ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. صحيح مسلم شريف کی روایت, نبی صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم said, indeed on the day of قیامت, Allah Almighty will not look at your bodily forms. Allah Almighty will not look at your ajsad. Allah will not look at whether you are tall or short, fat or skinny. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Nor will Allah Almighty look at your suwar as well. Allah Almighty will not look at your form. He will not look at whether you are wearing Gucci or Prada. He will not look at whether you are wearing a jubbah or a niqab. What will Allah look at on the day of Qiyamah? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told you and me that Allah Almighty will look at three things on the day of Qiyamah. Allah Almighty, number one, we look at the state of our hearts. And Quran is testification of this as well. Allah Almighty says in Surah Al-Furqan, لَيَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. That on the day of Qiyamah, your mal or dawlat will not benefit you. On the day of Qiyamah, your bibi bachya aulaad will not give you nafa or benefit. On the day of Qiyamah, the only one who will be successful is the one who comes into the court of Allah Almighty with a clean and pure heart. The one who comes in the court of Allah Almighty with a sincere heart, a heart which is free from all illnesses and diseases, a heart which is free from all malice and hatred towards the people, a heart which is pure. Dil hai wo dil jo teri yaad se mamur raha, sar hai wo sar jo tere kadmon pe qurban hua. Are dil, heart is that heart.
Ala Hazrat, Ala Hazrat.
Heart is that heart which is absorbed in the ishq al ghulami of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Dil hai wo dil jo teri yaad se mamur raha. Remember, two loves cannot exist in one heart. This is what the tasawwuf teaches us. This is what our akabirin and the ulama and the awliya and the sufiya have mentioned before us. The two loves cannot exist in one heart. Love of the dunya and love of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Two cannot exist in one heart. One heart, one love. This is why Allah Hazrat Azim wa Barakat, they say that when, if you were to open my chest, famous revival, if you were to open my chest and you were to take out my heart, on one side of my heart you'll see written La ilaha illallah. Allahu Akbar. Allah Hazrat, kya baat hai na? They said that if you were to open my chest, take out my heart, on one side of my heart you'll see written La ilaha illallah. And they said on the other side of my heart you'll see written Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahu Akbar. Allah will look at our hearts on the day of Qiyamah. Tasawwuf, this concept of spirituality, is purification of the heart. Similarly, Allah Almighty Jalla Jalaluhu, by way of the riwayat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we look at our intentions on the day of Qiyamah. How clean and how pure were we in our niyat? How clean and pure were we in our intentions? And whether there was ikhlas and sincerity in them intentions. Today we do things for a bit of fame. Shohara, people will call us an alim, people will call us a qari, people will call us a naat khan. We do it so people will give us respect and honor. Very few people actually do it for the sake of Allah Almighty Jalla Jalaluhu. Allahu Akbar. Remind yourself of that riwayat, Sahih Muslim Sharif. Three types of people will come into the court of Allah Almighty on the day of Qiyamah. Ilmul Ghaib and Nabi Salatu Wasalam. Tajdari Madina over 1400 years ago told you and me exactly what will happen on the day of Qiyamah. Three types of people will come. The first type of person will be a shaheed. Allah Almighty will question him, huh? What did you do for my sake? He will say, Ya Allah, I gave my life for your sake. Mafhuman. I sacrificed my life for your sake. I laid down my garden for your sake. Ya Allah, I became a shaheed. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, you have lied. Allah will say, you have lied. You didn't do it for my sake. You did it for the sake of the people. So people will call you a ghazi. People will call you a shaheed. You wanted honor and fame from the people. Go ask the people for honor and fame. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will then tell the malaika, drag this shaheed on his face and throw him into the fires of Jahannam. Allah, that shaheed that Allah talks about in the Quran, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Lekin there was no ikhlas, no sincerity in his intentions. Similarly, second group of people will come. Qari of the Quran, baz riwayat mein ulama of the deen. Again, Allah will ask them, what did you do for my sake? This is a practical message that we can take away from us or from this gathering. These are the teachings of tasawwuf and spirituality that we need to implement into our lives. Time does it permit to open the full bab and the full discussion? Allahu Akbar. Qari of the Quran, alim of the deen. He will come in the court of Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala. Allah will ask him, what did you do? He will say, Ya Allah, I served your deen. Recited the Quran for your sake. Taught the Quran. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. Ya Allah, I was amongst those people who learned the Quran, taught the Quran to the people. Allah Almighty will say, you have lied. Are qari of the Quran, alim of the deen. Those ulama that Allah talks about in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَا. Allah Almighty says, you have lied. You have lied. You didn't do it for my sake. You did it so people call you, Mufti Azim Britannia.
You did it so people will call you Sheikh al-Islam.
You did it so people will give you titles. You did it for the sake of the people. Ultimately go ask the people for the reward and the ajr and jaza. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will then tell the malaika, drag this alim of the deen, qari of the Quran, and throw him into the fires of Jahannam. What's left? Where do we stand today? This is what the tasawwuf and spirituality teaches us. Allah Almighty on the day of Qiyamah will look at our intentions, our niyyat. Then the third group of people are those people who used to give a lot of sadaqah in the way of Allah Almighty. Rich person, ghani person, Allah Almighty will say, what did you do for my sake? Mafhooman. And that person will say, ya Allah, give charity, sadaqah in your way. I did it so that we built the masajids. We did khidmat of the deen. Allah Almighty will say, you have lied. You didn't do it for my sake. You did it so people will call you a rich person. Chaudhry sahab gave £200. Raja sahab gave £300 today. You did it for the sake of the people. Allahu Akbar. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will tell the malaika, drag this rich person who used to give sadaqah in my way. Drag him on his face and throw him into the fires of Jahannam. Where do we stand today? This is what the tasawwuf and spirituality teaches us. That we cleanse our heart, we purify our intentions, we become those people who are sincere in our actions. And sincerity, ulama mentioned, is only by way of following the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ittiba'un Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ikhlas is that from head to toe you become a reflection of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ikhlas, sincerity, is that people look at you and they don't say, there goes a terrorist and an extremist. They say, there goes an ashik of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There goes a ghulam of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. Those people who truly implemented the teachings of tasawwuf into their lives, they became a reflection and an axe of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Or akhri baat, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah Almighty will look at our heart on the day of Qiyamah. And this is tasawwuf. Allah Almighty will look at our intentions on the day of Qiyamah. Or Allah Almighty will look at also our actions on the day of Qiyamah as well. Our a'mal, did them intentions actually transpire into actions? Allahu Akbar. So we need to ask ourselves, where do we stand today? It's important. Slightly changing our direction in the mawzu. And tackling a problem which is a disease now within our society. It is important that just as we find a doctor to cure our physical illnesses, we also find a doctor and a person who can cure our spiritual illnesses as well. But sadly today, we have many individuals who are false claimants of tasawwuf, jahil and parpeer, ignorant individuals who are claiming to be the Sufiya of our time, the awliya of our time, but in reality they are nothing. Ala Hazrat Azim wa Barakat in the fatawa mentioned four conditions of a murshid kamil. Waqt thora na. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala talks about this all in the Quran as well. Wabtaghu ilayhi al-wasilata. Surah Al-Ma'idah, surah number 5, verse number 35. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, seek a means of medium towards me, a means of proximity to me. Today people say, where is the proof and the dalil of having a murshid in light of the Quran? Under this ayat of the Quran, Shah Waliullah Muhaddis Dehlvi rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, or Ismail Dehlvi as well, they mention that here Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is saying that how do you seek a means and proximity to Allah? You do this by finding yourself a murshid kamil, by finding yourself a spiritual guide. But there are conditions to finding yourself a guide. A guide isn't he who has the largest number of followings, largest number of murids. That's not a guide. That's not a murshid. A murshid is he who fulfills the conditions of Ala Hazrat Imam Ahmad Riza Khan alayhi rahmat wa ridwan. Very quickly. Ala Hazrat mentions how many conditions? Bolo tasina. Four conditions. Ala Hazrat mentioned very quickly, we'll mention them as well. Those of you who are looking and seeking for a murshid, judge it by this criteria that Ala Hazrat has set for us. Or Shaykh Abdullah Siraj, side point. Shaykh Abdullah Sirajuddin al-Husayni mentions in his book, Ghaliban as-salatu ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if a person cannot find a murshid kamil, if a person cannot find a peer kamil, then what should he do? That person should send durood and salawat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then ultimately Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes his murshid. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes his guide. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. Lekin Ala Hazrat mentions four conditions. Number one, that person must be from the Ahli Sunnati wal Jamaat. A murtad cannot be a peer. A person who is ghair Ahli Sunnati wal Jamaat cannot be a sheikh, cannot be a guide. First condition is that person must be from the Ahli Sunnati wal Jamaat. Number two, that individual must be an alim of the deen. He must be a scholar. This is why when Mehboob Ilahi Khwaja Sayyid Nizamuddin Awliya Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, when they would give khilafat, they wouldn't give khilafat to anybody. As Ustaz Sahib said, Adkar, khilafat isna log deni isna ravia ban rahe hain. Ravia something, you know? Sweets, huh? People give khilafat today like giving out sweets and distributing sweets. It will become a joke today. But Nizamuddin Awliya Rahmatullahi Alayhi, who was the disciple of Baba Fariduddin Ganshakar Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. And Baba Fariduddin Ganshakar Rahmatullahi Alayhi, he was that individual who was the murid and the disciple of Hazrat Khwaja Qutbuddin Bakhtiyar Kaki Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. And we know Khwaja Qutbuddin Bakhtiyar Kaki was the murid and the disciple of the great Khwaja Khwajagan, Khwaja Gharib Nawaz Alayhi Rahmat wa Ridwan, Khwaja Sayyid Mu'inuddin Hassan Ajmeri Sanjari Rahmatullahi Alayhi. Khwaja Nizamuddin Awliya, they would not give khilafah to anybody who was not an alim of the deen. He had over 700 khulafa. 700 khulafa. And the condition of giving khilafat was that person had to be an alim of the deen. You know this book that we study in Darsi Nizami, Hidayatul Nahw. The one who authored this book was Sirajuddin Uthman Nizami Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. Do you know that he became an alim of the deen in 6 months? Hazrat Fakhruddin Zarrati Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, who was a senior murid of Khwaja Sayyid Nizamuddin Awliya, he made Sirajuddin Uthman into a full-fledged scholar in 6 months. Then they gave khilafat to him. And they said, now go to West Bengal and spread Islam. Allahu Akbar. Very quickly, they've told me to wind up. Third condition of a peer or murshid is that individual, zahiran or batinan, he should follow and act upon the teachings of the Quran and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar. One person heard that Khwaja Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi would fly in the skies and walk on the water. Seeing is believing. He wanted to see for himself. So he went to Baghdad Sharif, sat in the majalis and the gatherings of Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. After several days, he didn't see anything. He did see some things. Tasawwuf. He saw that when the sheikh would go in public, he would wear the best of clothing. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. When they would go in public in front of the people, they would wear the best of clothing. But in private, in private, behind closed doors, they would wear ragged clothing, patched clothing. This was their taqwa, their connection with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Second quality that they noticed was that they used to, when their guests used to come, they gave the best of foods to their guests. Best of foods. But when they were eating alone, they used to eat the leftovers and the crumbs of their guests. Ye taqwa hai na, ye tasawwuf hai, that you don't wish ill of anyone. After a few days, this person didn't see Junaid Baghdadi flying in the sky or walking on the water. He was about to leave. Junaid Baghdadi called him and they said, I have noticed that you've sat in my gatherings. Tell me, why did you come? He goes, Huzur, I heard that you were flying in the skies, walking on the water. I wanted to see for myself. Jawab suno. Junaid Baghdadi said, during this time, have you seen me go against the Quran? Allahu Akbar. Have you seen me go against the Quran by way of my aqwal wa af'al? They said, Huzur, no. None of your actions, none of your statements have gone against the Quran. They go that during this time, have you seen me go against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They said, no, Huzur. Everything that you've done has been a reflection and embodiment of the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said at that point that this is my greatest miracle. This is my greatest karama. This is why Huzur Ziyal Ummat rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, Peer Karam Shah Al-Azhari rahmatullahi alayhi, they said, al-istiqamatu fawqal karama. Istiqamat, steadfastness, this is greater than a karamat, greater than a miracle. So that individual who is a peer or murshid, the third condition is this, that person, zahiran, batinan, externally and internally, should reflect the Quran and the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Last point, fourth condition, murshid kamil is who? In this day and age, use this criteria. They say murshid kamil is he. Ala Hazrat mentions that a murshid kamil is he whose chain goes back all the way to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's put his hand in the hand of his sheikh, who's put the hand in the hand of his sheikh, who's put his hand in the hand of his sheikh, all the way back to Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala. And Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu put the hand in the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Enough has been said, enough has been mentioned. Become those people who implement tasawwuf into your lives. And if you read the books, Al-Risalatul Kushayriya of Imam Abu Qasim Al-Kushayri or Huzudat Ali Hujwari's Kashful Mahjub and other books, Akhribah, they said that tasawwuf, apart from the things that we mentioned, they said that tasawwuf is husnul khuluq, is good character. Learn to treat one another with honor and respect. Demonstrate good character towards one another. Become those people who smile and revive this prophetic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Wa ma alayna illa al-balaghul mubin.
MashaAllah, that was our honorable guest speaker, Imam Muhammad Adil Shahzad, if time permitted. We would have allowed Imam Sahib more time, but unfortunately time is always against us. Therefore, I will request each and every one of my honorable and esteemed guests, due to the time constraint, please remain within the time limit. And the only reason for that is there are a number of speakers remaining, and therefore we have to do justice to each and every one speaker. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward Imam Muhammad Adil Shahzad, increase him so the youngsters are able to benefit from him and his works for a very long time to come. For the brothers who joined us late, you'll know perhaps on your arrival, you were given a very small piece of paper which the Sunni Foundation have given you, requesting your personal details, so your name, your email and your mobile number. And the reason for this is so we're able to provide you with information in relation to forthcoming events. There's a monthly newsletter which will begin very soon, inshallah. And as you see, it's the first annual Sunni conference, inshallah. There's going to be many more very similar to this. We want to keep you informed. We want to keep you up to date. So therefore, we would request that you fill these out and return them to the responsible brothers. The brothers standing on the doors, if I kindly request that you either take a seat inside the masjid hall, or if there's no room, then you kindly make your way downstairs. We need to make sure that the doorway is clear for entry and exit and for help.